During the Cold War, military aircraft manufacturers were really pushing the envelope of what was capable with their designs. In Britain, for example, the British Aircraft Company was producing the TSR-2. This was a Mach 2-capable strike and reconnaissance aircraft that was designed to deliver a nuclear payload into the heart of the Soviet Union. It was an ambitious aircraft, but one that never progressed, controversially, beyond the prototype stage. And one reason for the aircraft's failure was thanks to the American General Dynamics F-111 Aardvark. The General Dynamics F-111 Aardvark was a supersonic, mid-range interdictor and tactical aircraft fighter jet, as well as a strategic nuclear bomber. In the early 1960s, the Air Force came to realize that new, radar-guided surface-to-air missiles such as the Soviet SA-2 could reach its slow, high-altitude bombers. In response, it devised a new concept, a smaller, long-range supersonic bomber that could skim close to the ground below radar systems. At the same time, the U.S. Navy was looking for a fast, long-range carrier-based interceptor, armed with air-to-air missiles that could take out Soviet bombers from a distance. The F-111 was one of America's most ambitious aircraft projects of the Cold War, with various cost overruns hurting its reputation. But despite that, it did prove to be a highly capable machine in various roles and served with the Air Force until the 1990s. The F-111 was a trailblazer for aircraft tech, with examples being its afterburning turbofan engines, swept wing, and automatic terrain-following radar. With its pioneering characteristics and a top speed of 1,650 miles per hour, this high-speed, variable sweep-wing aircraft has earned its place in military history. The F-111 would become the first production variable geometry wing aircraft, and it would enter service with the United States Air Force in July 1967. Their first combat missions would be in March 1968, when the F-111 was sent to Southeast Asia, where they would strike targets in North Vietnam. The aircraft would serve alongside the likes of the F-4 Phantom. However, the loss of three of them halted combat operations for the aircraft, although at least one of those losses was due to a hydraulic issue and not enemy fire. The F-111 would go on to participate in Operation Linebacker in 1972, and the jet was starting to show its worth. The F-111 had a relatively high service ceiling of 66,000 feet. Of course, this was helpful on long-haul intercontinental flights, but with the purpose of the F-111 being to enter airspace while remaining under the radar, it was its low-altitude capacity that really mattered. The bomber was designed to fly at a height of just 200 feet above the ground and at a speed of up to 550 miles per hour or more. This made the F-111 a highly practical choice for entering other territories with minimal chance of detection. While the F-111 could reach 915 miles per hour at sea level, it could soar to 1,650 miles per hour at cruising altitude, or approximately Mach 2.15. Though certainly shy of the record-breaking speeds of aircraft like the Lockheed YF-12A, which had reached up to 3,331.5 miles per hour in 1965, this speed still provided the aircraft with supersonic flight. The F-111 was a multi-armament bomber with one 20mm six-barreled Gatling cannon gun and 9 hardpoints. As for the missiles, the Aardvark could drop an AGM-69 SRAM thermonuclear weapon or an AGM-130 standoff bomb. With a 100,000-pound payload capacity, the F-111 could also drop free-fall general-use bombs, such as the 2,000-pound MK-84, 750-pound MK-117, and 1,000-pound MK-83. It could also be used to drop cluster bombs and B-61 or B-43 nukes, among other weapons. One feature that really secured the F-111's place in history is that it was a variable sweep or variable geometry wing aircraft. This groundbreaking swing-wing fighter jet could sweep back its wings before returning them to their original position mid-flight. This technology allowed the F-111 to modify its shape while soaring through the air. The Soviet Union would introduce several similar designs throughout the 60s, including the Sukhoi Su-17 or Fitter in 1965. Later, the US would add a second variable sweep wing bomber in the form of the Rockwell B-1 Lancer in 1974. The F-111 would see usage with the United States Air Force from 1967 through to 1998, The type would see use in Operation Desert Storm of the Gulf War in 1991. There, F-111Fs would complete various strike missions, predominantly against Iraqi tanks and armored vehicles. Some 1,500 Iraqi armored vehicles were destroyed by the F-111s, and their use in this anti-armor role soon earned the name tank planking. Despite the aircraft's successes, however, only one other air arm would fly the F-111. That was the Royal Australian Air Force. Dubbed the Pig in Australia thanks to its long nose, the F-111 entered Royal Australian Air Force service in September 1968. Here, they replaced the Australians' English electric Canberras from Britain. Ironically, the TSR-2 was meant to replace the Canberra in both Britain and potentially Australia too. The F-111 never saw combat service with Australia, but would become a staple member of the Air Force for decades. The Australians would fly the aircraft longer than America would, and the final flight of the F-111s was at the end of 2010. And with it, the career of one of the Cold War's most innovative aircraft was finally over.